Morning, everybody. Father Don.
Father Danny.
And we're back with Divinely Inspired
2.0
back again. Unfortunately, back in lockdown, and we'll see how long that the authorities and the bishops proceed forward with this. If we go into February, we just end in January, hopefully, and come back up again so we can gather in our limited spaces, limited numbers, and go directly from there. A gentle reminder again that masks are mandatory when we come to mass. We come to mass when it's open, that unless you have a doctor's note given to myself, pastor, wherever church you belong to, that you will not be allowed in the church unless you actually have a doctor's note for not being able to wear a mask, and then you'll be seated in a certain area of the church. Here it'll be in the chapel area, and I will bring communion directly down to you. He will not come up for communion. I'll bring communion to you if you cannot wear a mask when you come to church. Special welcome to Father Michael Bayshard, who has been appointed as the pastor of the family of parishes of St. John the Divine and St. George's Church. And congratulations to Father John Jaska, who is heading to the Chatham Catholic family of parishes in July, where he will be the pastor down there. Father Pedro will remain as your associate pastor. And as soon as I get to talk to the bishop, which should be in the next week or two, I'll be able to reveal to yourselves where I am off to. And then I have a letter penned already, just waiting for that affirmation for myself that I'm able to release that letter in regards to, we'll have it on the website. I'll ask Rick Vandekie if he can put it on it. And Pam, our secretary, will put the letter into the bulletin so that you can all read that. Today we're going to talk about something very important. I've had a few people come and call me about it, email, and actually come talk to me about it, is the vaccine, the COVID vaccine. There's a lot of troubling, how do I put it? There's a troubling atmosphere and a fear out there over the vaccine. Danny, have you heard anything yourself personally?
Yeah, there's a lot of kind of questions about what is the Catholic morality of receiving the vaccine. I've heard as far as people saying it changes your DNA, and I'm wondering, where did this come from?
Changing your DNA. I've never, ever, ever heard anything like this before. This is ridiculous. I've heard through the grapevine in the wind, as far to say that this will turn you into a reptile. Is this a Tolkien novel? I've never heard this. Or God will not recognize you because it'll change your DNA. Brothers and sisters, this is nonsense. Don't listen to this personally, please. Don't go on websites and look for conspiracy theorists in this regard. This is nonsense. Absolutely absurd. And if people are telling you stuff like this, I'm recommending you not listen to them. And when it comes to that, just walk away. In charity, walk away from them and don't listen to that. That's bizarrely, I've never heard anything like this.
Never. I've also heard things such as, you know, it's the mark of the beast. And I'm like, where is this coming from?
Yeah, this is not right. This is incorrect. So Father Danny, we're going to post at the end of our session here at the bottom, from the Congregation to the Doctrine of the Faith, from the Canadian bishops, and from the American Conference of Catholic Bishops. And they did their writings on the moral concerns and the creation of vaccines and COVID vaccine. So you'll be able to read those in regards to and follow what the church's teachings are now in regards to, and make your choice accordingly. According to the common good, it's something that our church says we need to follow. Even though the two strains may be remotely related to the aborted tissues back from the 60s, two of the strains are remotely related. The common good of humanity at this point and charity towards our brothers and sisters trumps that as we move forward in terms of vaccinations. Can you speak a little bit more to that, Dan?
Sure. The understanding behind the church's vision here is this idea of evil and cooperation. The principle is, because our world is in a fallen state, in some way we're always going to participate with evil. Now, it doesn't mean we actively participate, such as sin, but there are certain things that are remote participation. I'll give a perfect example. Father Don, do you pay your taxes?
Yes, I do.
Because, you know, we hear from Christ, render to Caesar what is Caesar's and render to God what is God's.
Correct.
But the truth of the matter is we know our tax dollars doesn't always go to the most morally correct things. It goes towards abortions, now with euthanasia. It goes towards certain social dimensions that the church doesn't agree with. But would you say it's a moral responsibility as a Catholic priest and as a Catholic man to pay your taxes?
Yes, for the common good of our country, yes.
So it's the same thing with this vaccine. This vaccine, as you said beautifully, these strains are very remotely connected to this aborted tissue. As Catholics, we do our best to try to avoid receiving vaccines that are have aborted tissue. But in this case of the common good and the church's understanding, again, the magisterial, which is the teaching body of the church, has said this is fine. There should be no Catholic here that could say to another Catholic, you're going to go to hell for receiving this vaccine.
No, definitely not. Not at all. And it says right here, too, in one of the papers, in view of the gravity of the current pandemic and lack of availability of alternative vaccines, the reasons to accept the new COVID vaccines from Pfizer and Moderna are sufficiently serious to justify their use, despite the remote connection to morally compromised cell lines. Now, there's another one from AstraZeneca. Although it's more morally compromised, it's still, if that's the one that's available, it's still morally responsible to get vaccinated if that's the only one available. In regards to, the bishops are saying that it's still responsible for us to have to get vaccinated in regards to. This is currently a worldwide pandemic that we're facing here, and the vaccinations are necessary in charity to help stop the consistent and constant spread of the virus.
So I'm guessing if people come to your office, Father Don, for confession, you don't want to hear, Father, I received the vaccine, that's my
sin. That's not a sin. And it's been stated here by the bishops, brothers and sisters, from Rome, from the Congregation, Doctrine of the Faith, from the Canadian bishops, from the American bishops, in regards to, this is not a sin in receiving your vaccination against COVID-19. Don't bring it to the confessional for any priest, wherever you are or wherever you go. It's not, they don't want to hear it. It's not a sin. It's not necessary. The apostles of Christ have given us permission and taking to his teaching, and away we go in regards to. And it's fine. It's not a problem.
No, I don't see an issue with it. And I think it's important for people to be aware that there's a lot of sources out there that are going to say, don't listen to these documents, don't listen to the bishops. That's not a Catholic thing.
That's unfortunate these conspiracy theorists preaching disobedience, civil disobedience, disobedience to church authorities, for some purpose and some reason. I don't know where this is coming from. This is not church teaching. This is not private revelation from any saints of the Catholic Church in regards to, and it doesn't come from God.
No, I hopefully these documents that we're going to share on the show notes, so people can read over them. They can pray over them. And if there's anyone in their family or friends, they're saying, you know, I heard that this is, you know, dangerous, this is unhealthy, or worse, this is a sin, they could share these documents and say, not according to our shepherds. Our shepherds say this is clearly right from Rome all the way to our local authorities.
Yeah, it's wonderfully, excuse me, I think it's wonderfully worded right across the board from both conferences and from Rome. Going through there, explaining the common good, explaining the danger that we face from the pandemic, and explaining moral complicity and the moral imperative, etc., all the way across the board, and the reason that we need to be receiving the vaccinations in regards to. So we'll have that posted at the bottom of our sheet. At the bottom of our program today. If you have any more questions or anything, please email me in so that Father Danny and I can bring it up during the course of our show, and we'll go from there. Is there anything else, Father Danny, that you wanted to add?
Just a reminder to visit the website SJTD for more information about what's going on in the parish, but also there's a link there under the Year of St. Joseph for those who are interested in the idea of plenary indulgences. We've talked about it before.
Oh, can you touch on that a little bit more,
sure.
Father Danny, for us, please?
Sure. So
why the Year of St. Joseph all of a sudden? Why?
It's the 150th anniversary since, I believe it's Pius the 12th, declared St. Joseph as patron of the church, or it's Pius X, I can't remember who it is.
Okay.
But the idea behind it, he's patron of the Universal Church. So Pope Francis, in his wisdom, called this the year of St. Joseph. It's a time to understand Joseph's role. And I know in Scripture it's very quiet, but Joseph had a major role to play with the Holy Family.
Uh-huh.
Part of that recognition is also the graces that come from his intercession. So there's the idea of what's called plenary indulgences, which is removing time from purgatory. In this case, plenary meaning full time from purgatory. We can apply it to ourselves, or we can apply it to a family member who's gone before us.
Oh, that's wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
So online, it'll tell you how to receive it very simply. When available, try to come to confession. Receiving Holy Communion once available, even spiritually. And doing our best to avoid sin, especially serious sin.
So the spiritual communion would make up for the actual receiving corporally of our Lord in the Eucharist in,
yes.
the, in this time.
Yes, it would. Yes, and the idea behind the ability to receive it is the desire to go to confession for mortal sin as soon as it's made fully available. But with yourself, with you having appointments, you can still hear confessions. But
and the bishop has allowed that. So Bishop Favreau has allowed us to receive confessions by appointment. If you come in, we sterilize our hands, we wear a mask, and I fog out my office with our disinfected fogger before and after, so everything's been looked after in that regard, and there's social distancing within the space also, so we're not sitting on top of each other in close proximity, and you can go to confession in regards to. Was there anything else you wanted to add, Paul?
Yeah, there's a number of ways to receive that plenary indulgence, so that's just the kind of the stipulation to start it up, the confession, Eucharist, detachment from sin.
Pray for our Holy Father.
Praying for our Holy Father as well. And then there's about, I believe there's 7 or 8 different ways to receive that plenary indulgence. One of them is simple. I know, I remember reading, praying the rosary as a family.
Okay.
So that's one simple example.
Do you know any other examples?
Remember any other? There was one for praying the Litany of St. Joseph. The Litany of St. Joseph, which you can find online and also in many Catholic good Catholic books, prayer books. But if you go on the website and click on that link, it'll take you to the document and it'll show you exactly
it'll show you what's available. That was what we posted up there.
That's what we posted, yes.
Okay, perfect, excellent. So like I said, take care. Again, congratulations to Father Michael Bayshard. Very happy for you. And congratulations to Father John Jaska as being appointed in Chatham as the family of parish's pastor down there. And I will release a letter that I have penned directly when I find out, when I talk to the bishop at his earliest convenience, maybe in a couple of weeks, a week or two. In that regard, and we can go from there. Any other questions, please, and anything that you would like to know that's bothering you, please send it in, and we'll take it and we'll bring it forth to our Friday morning chat and get together. We'll try to answer it as best we can. Other than that, have a great day, everybody, and God bless you all.
Take care. I'm going to go to the hospital.